Happy Sabbath, everyone. It's good to see you all. We're going to go into our next session at this moment. We have Pastor Paul's wife, Sister Elena Paul, who has had a vast experience in many years being a minister's wife who travels a lot. And I want to praise God for giving us the privilege to learn a lot more about himself and his desire for godly relationships in these last days. I'm going to pray for Sister Elena just before she begins, and I'd like you all to join me in prayer. So let us pray. Divine Father, we want to thank you for the privilege, the gift, and the honor of knowing that we are children of God. I thank you so much. Father, you have not just created us, but you've assured us that you will not leave us unguided in these last days. And so I praise thee for your desire to establish godly homes, Father, for we have seen how our homes are disturbingly attacked by the evil one. Father, may you please speak. We humbly plead mightier and mightier this evening. We pray in a special way for your daughter, who you have anointed with your Spirit, to speak to us the truth of Jesus Christ. I thank you, dear Father, as she emphasizes our net worth in the eyes of God. May you please humble us, empty us of self, anoint your daughter all over again, dear Lord. May you remove any fear, anxiety, anything that would hinder the ministry. May you cast it asunder and allow God to be magnified in our midst. We praise thee, dear God, and thank thee for answering our prayer, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Our family is very delighted to be here to serve the Lord in this capacity of sharing what we have experienced in the Lord, myself and my husband. I believe God has chosen us to serve him. Do you want to know how we met? The story goes back to 15 years. Flashback. I finished my nursing almost in my internship, and then God impressed on my mind that I should marry a pastor. I thought I'll marry a doctor, but God impressed on my mind that I should marry a pastor. And during one of the spiritual retreats, they said, if you're going to marry someone in the near future, start praying for that person, even if you don't know the person. And so I was saying, Lord, you asked me to marry a pastor, and I don't know who is he, where is he. I know he's there somewhere in this world, and I don't know when I'm going to meet him. I don't know how he looks. But I know you know him, you have created him, and I know in your own time you'll bring him to me. And I said, for me to identify the man, I'm asking you to show me some signs. So I asked God for 5 signs. He should be a pastor, preacher, and then he should be tall, dark, and handsome, and he should have some musical ability, maybe some instrument or singing or something like that. And there is this 5th one, a secular wish. Those days, Michael Learns to Rock, famous song, Paint My Love, was very famous. The young people used to sing in the social programs. It used to be played in the dorms. My roommate had a tape, those days tape recorder, and we used to listen to the song now and then. And I really enjoyed the lyrics, and I wished someday the one I'm going to marry would dedicate this song to me. And I was asking the Lord for these 5 signs. And my sister said one day that there is a man who's interested in you, and he might come and see you. But she never showed the picture, nor told his name. So here I am. The pastor of my church said, there is a preacher coming next Sabbath, why don't you sing? I have no idea what was going to happen. And then when I saw him, I began to sense there is something happening. Maybe this is the man my sister was talking about. Yeah, and when they said his name, I kind of began to understand. And he looked tall, dark, and handsome. And after the Vespers, we met, shook hands, then we kind of introduced ourselves. And the following day, he preached, and I sang. And then, yeah, he was a good preacher. And I know he's a pastor. Three signs fulfilled. And then after lunch, we sat, and we were talking about our passion to serve the Lord. We were talking about how God has impressed on my mind to marry a minister and how the burden I have to serve the Lord in his vineyard. And he was sharing how the Lord has chosen him and all the passion he has to serve God. And he said, if you're going to marry me, you know, you have to be very sacrificial. And, you know, I'm going to be very busy. Sometimes you may be lonely. And he was kind of preparing me. It's as though he already decided that he's going to marry me. And in the first meeting itself, in the first 3 hours we were talking, we kind of felt we are going to be married. And all our talk was so much about the passion to serve the Lord. And then after that, he went into the church just like this one that afternoon. He was playing the piano. There were many people. We had a meeting, and they were all around. And then I knew all the four signs were fulfilled, and I was thinking maybe God may not fulfill the fifth one because it is secular one. Maybe I have not asked the right thing. But the following, the visit, he comes up with a Walkman, and he says, I have a song for you, and this song is dedicated to you. But I never said this wish of mine to anyone except God. And then when the music began, I recognized the song. It's the same song I was praying that someone would dedicate it to me. Not someone, the one I'm going to marry. And so it's been my love. So all my five signs have been fulfilled. And I knew he's the one. And there was no turning back ever since. And the following year, we got married. So that's how God led both of us, two complete strangers, two imperfect people. We are not perfect, but God has chosen us, and he is teaching us, molding us, preparing us step by step for his service. We are learning, we are growing, we are so imperfect. The first 5 years of our marriage were very troublesome. Actually, the first 6 months, we were working in the slums of a big city where he was pastoring two slum churches, and I was with him trying to learn the language, and God taught me many things. We worked together, traveled places together. That time no kids, so we were like free birds. I'm so happy that my kids are here, so we are so blessed. And after 6 months, we are transferred to another place, and our trouble began. In the span of 5 years, I had three missed abortions. It was a natural one by itself. We don't know why. Only God has the answers. In the process, I was on bed rest for the second and third pregnancies. But still, I lost, and I was gaining weight. I knew God has chosen me to spread the health message because I'm a nurse. I was trying to do whatever I can with the knowledge I have. I knew that was what God has chosen me to do. I was gaining weight, and how can I talk about health when I'm not looking fit? I was doing all kinds of things to reduce. Maybe I would reduce and I would gain again. Ultimately, we came here to IAS with our two beautiful girls, Melita and Lydia. I had these issues with my weight gain, and somebody also commented, if you are a health person, how could you talk about health when you don't look fit? And kind of put me into a shell that God has chosen me to give the health message, and why I don't look fit, and I'm trying my best to do everything possible. Maybe I need to work hard. It put me into a depression and shell. My husband would say, come, at least give 10 minutes of health talk before I would preach. And I finished my public health, master's in public health. I have all the resources, knowledge, but I didn't feel fit enough to talk about health because of the way I look. But God gave me another message, not about health. your total net worth, the way the world looks at us and values us. Let's see how the way how the world views us and values us. It values us based on the status. Which status in the society you belong to, the upper, middle, lower. Sometimes they would say, oh, he's from a royal family. Oh, she is from that influential family. You know, they brand you based on which part of the society you come from. Oh, she's working in Makati. You know, there's a big wow. And then, oh, she, and somebody from the lower will say, oh, okay, okay. You know, kind of expressions people give about the high, middle, and low. You know, these are all man-made, and this is how the world values us. Let's see how the world values us based on our possessions, what we have. The money we have, the wealth we have, how many buildings, how much of land. People value us. In some countries, like my country, they ask how much your dad is earning, how much of wealth you all have. You know, if they want to give a girl or a boy in marriage, how much you have, how much we have, they want to talk about all those things, and they value based on that. If they're from a rich family, they want to give the girl there, or a rich even the boy the other way. So they value us based on the possession. People value us based on our looks. See, I was not valued much because I looked big. Sometimes, you know, when you look big, they say, oh, you're not fit for giving health message. You know, sometimes the way people look at you and say, oh, she's so fat, or she's so thin. You know, though, oh, she's got the saloon look, she's got the straight bonded hair, you know, curly hair. The way people look at you and value you based on our looks, if you look fashionable, they think you are very valuable. So the world views us based on these three things, status, position, and looks. And they say, that's what you're worth. Let's see some examples of celebrities who have achieved all this and how they feel. Can you recognize her? Yeah, she's one of the famous celebrities, singer, and she even acts in Hollywood. And then she says, I have so much common sense and street smart. I had this confidence in what I could do, but I don't have so much confidence in who I was and what I had to offer just a girl, as a girl. She doesn't feel worthy that she's a girl. Jennifer Lopez. Angelina Jolie, you an ambassador and a famous Hollywood actress. You know what she says? I struggle with low self-esteem all the time. I have so much wrong with me. It's unbelievable. These people have looks, possession, status, and still they feel so low within. There's another famous singer. She says, when I go off stage, I'd come back to my room and I'd be alone. And she has this addiction problem, bulimia, and she hurts herself. You know, by pinching and hurting her skin, her body. That's kind of addiction she has, thinking that she's not good enough. And this is another actor, Will Smith. I still doubt myself every single day. What people believe in my self-confidence is actually my reaction to fear. He's another famous guy in Beatles group, 60s, 70s, very famous. He says, throughout his life, even during the height of Beatlemania, he had poor self-esteem, and though he looked confident. Whitney Houston, The Voice, another famous singer, you know, despite her success and worldwide fame, she always wondered, am I good enough? Am I pretty enough? Will they like me? Always trying to feel valuable in the sight of others. Will they like me? Will they like me? Will I fit into the society? She says, the biggest devil is me. I'm either my best friend or my worst enemy. While her best friend made her very successful in the business of her life, in the end, it was her enemy in her that caused a tragic fall for a superstar who was one of the top-selling artists in pop music history. with more than 55 million records sold in US alone. You know, she was so much addicted to drugs, narcotics. Her CR is filled with all of them. She couldn't care for herself, and she was in a very miserable stage in the end when she died. All these people, they've done so exceptional things. They had the status, looks, possession, still felt so unworthy of themselves. Why? Why? Because the sin has created that vacuum in our hearts, the emptiness in our heart. And let's see the verse, Luke 11:24-26. When the evil spirit comes out of a man, it wanders through a waterless places looking for rest. When it fails to find any, it says, I will go back to my house from which I came. When it arrives, it finds it cleaned and all in order. Then it goes and collects seven other spirits more evil than itself to keep it company, and they all go in and make themselves at home. The last state of man is worse than the first. That says there is some emptiness. And who resides there in that emptiness? The evil spirit. The emptiness. We fill that emptiness with all these power, fame, deeds, academic titles, awards, rewards, wealth, fashion, etc. All these things, we try to fill that emptiness. We want to fill all of these into that emptiness, thinking that it will make us look worthy or make us feel worthy. Let's see if this is correct. Ephesians 2:1-3. Is worldly way God's way? That's what the world does. Is that God's way? It says, at one time you were like a dead person because of the things you did wrong and your offenses against God. You used to live like people of this world. You followed the rule of a destructive spiritual power. This is a spirit of disobedience to God's will that is now at work in persons whose lives are characterized by disobedience. At one point in time, you were like those persons. All of you used to do whatever felt good, whatever you thought you wanted, so that you were children headed for punishment, just like everyone else. The world's way is not God's way. The world follows a different power spirit. Let's see what is God's way. How does God's way is different from world's way? 1 Samuel 16:6-7. Here, Prophet Samuel, God said, you will choose the man whom I have appointed, and he goes to the sons and to choose the king for Israel. And then he looks at Eliab and he thinks, because he looked so tall and good body, he felt he is the one God has chosen. See, the Lord says to Samuel, have no regard for his appearance or stature, because I have not selected him. God doesn't look at things like humans do. Humans see only what is visible to the eyes, but the Lord sees into the heart. This is how God sees. There is a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man which cannot be filled by any created thing, but only by God, the Creator made known through Jesus. So life without Jesus is like a vacuum cleaner. It picks up all the dirt and dust particles around, because the vacuum cleaner has the vacuum inside, just like the vacuum we all have because of sin. And when there is no Jesus, we pick up everything the world offers and fill up and still feel unworthy about ourselves. Can this be translated to the church life as well? Could this be translated to church life as well? We are talking about the world. Status. I'm a vegan. It's a big status, right? I'm a vegan. And then you feel quite superior that you're a vegan. Or I've been to GC. Or status like, oh, I am so-and-so. I'm the elder. All right. Or I'm the superintendent. And the way you flare up yourself by the positions in the church, can this be translated into the church life? If there is no Jesus in us, yes, it can. The status in the church, or what the church could offer, or how many encyclopedias I have, how many Ellen White books I have, how many church institutions I visited, how many holy places I went. You know, you can show off with all that. What about possessions? As I said, how much I have, like the books, you know, how many books I have, or what are the collections I made over the years. You know, some people show off with all that. They're all very good things. There's nothing bad in that. But the attitude, we try to fill up our emptiness. The way we decorate our homes and say our home is better off than the others. They always compare the comparison. And we always want to compare ourselves with someone. Someone buys something, we want to buy something. You know, that is not at all a holy attitude, comparing ourselves. The looks, the Adventist look. See, she's wearing a short skirt. She's showing off her skin. You know, the way we judge people based on looks. Oh, she's so fat. Oh, she's not following a vegan diet. She doesn't follow Adventist health principles, you know, things like that. The way we judge people based on looks. Yeah, it can be. It could be translated into church life as well. Let's take a moment to pray to God about this. It can be a silent prayer. Take a minute or so. I would read it very slowly. Dear God, you know I have always struggled with insecurities. I have a warped perspective of who I am. It has been so challenging for me to disregard those thoughts of insecurity and lean on your truths. I ask that you would rewire my mind in Jesus' name. If you are a married person, I pray for the wife reading this prayer right now. There are so many pressures in this world. Pressures from the media, from society, from family, and so often from our own selves. I pray for the women who struggle with insecurity and feeling as if they do not measure up. Fill their hearts with peace. Give them your confidence and increase their faith in Jesus' name. It can apply to men as well. So the answer is Jesus. So when we have Jesus in us, what would happen to that emptiness? 1 Corinthians 12:13. There is no Jew, no Gentile, okay? There's no difference, but we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit, and we all share the same Spirit. When we have Jesus, that the feeling of one body, one Spirit, and we all share the same Spirit, so we are one family. There are no differences whatsoever. And we are so secure of what Jesus is to us. We have this new identity in Jesus, a new status. It's royal heritage. How do you know you have this royal heritage? 1 Peter 2:9. But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. You're not like that of the world, but you are a chosen people. Doesn't matter what people say, if they regard you as high, middle, or low class, don't worry about what people categorize you. You are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. We have this royal blood flowing in us because of Jesus. we have the royal heritage. We have this royal possession, the heavenly city. See what possession we have. Do you know what you own? Revelation 21, the walls was made of jasper, city of pure gold, pure as glass. The foundation of the city walls were decorated with every kind of precious stone. The foundation, the first was jasper, second sapphire, third agate, fourth emerald, fifth onyx, sixth ruby, then chrysolite, beryl, topaz, turquoise, jacinth, amethyst. There in 21 says the gates, 12 gates were 12 pearls, each gate made of single pearl, one pearl, the whole gate is carved. And the city was of gold, pure as transparent glass. This is what you and I possess. Let's see the crown of Miss Universe. You know how much of diamonds Miss Universe crown has? Only 311 pieces. The blue topaz is only 5 pieces. Sapphire, 198, crystal, 33, gold, 220 grams. Total weight is only 411 grams. That is the worth of Miss Universe crown. See what God has given you and me? You know, the square, the city is in a square stretching 1,500 miles. And the foundation is made with not stone, but precious stones, 12 precious stones, stretching 1,500 miles. What a comparison. There's nothing in front of the Miss Universe crown. That is what you and I are going to possess, or we already have it in Jesus, and we're going to see very soon when he comes. The foundation is made with all these 12 precious stones. Just read again Revelation 21. Meditate on that. The looks, we are in the image of God. Doesn't matter our hair is curly or straight. Doesn't matter you look fat or thin. Whichever complexion you have, doesn't matter from which race you come, it doesn't matter. The value we have is what God has made us. He made us in his own image, just like him. He has eyes, ears, hands, you know, the structure, just like him. And he has given us the brain and made us higher than other creatures to judge and think well and reason well. Colossians 3:10, and have put on a new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. So we are in his image. So we have these looks. Let's take a moment again to pray for this insecurity that we are suffering. Dear insecurity, do you have any idea how tired I am of you? I know I have made a place for you to stay in my life, a comfy place. But hear me now, Scat. I'm a child of God Almighty. In him my worth is secure and sure. He is now my comfy place. Isaiah 28:16. So this is what the Sovereign Lord says. See, I lay a stone in Zion, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone for a sure foundation. The one who relies on it will never be stricken with panic. Matthew 7:24, Jesus is a solid rock and our only hope of security. Jesus is the only hope of our security. You know what is your worth and my worth? We have this royal heritage. We have this heavenly royal city. We are in God's own image. When someone undermines your worth, or if you undermine your worth, just know who you are. You are a daughter and son of a king. This is our worth in Jesus. God bless us.